So you see a soft tissue at the attic or mesotympanum. As you can see here, there's a soft tissue here. The ossicular chain seems to be intact, at least here, but you see an air cell which looks like a coalescent cell, and there is a fluid level there. Okay, and there is no osseous erosions in this particular patient. Fluid level at the mastoid. There is a history. There was an otorrhea here. Patient has got an ear pain, and this is otomastoiditis. Okay, so this is very straightforward. As long as the ossicular chain is intact and there is no scotum erosion, you know, reasonable to suggest this is an otomastoiditis. So in acute, you tend to have fluid levels. There was no sclerosis, but in chronic, you start getting sclerosis and obliteration of cells. Here is a patient who has got lot of fluid attenuation, soft tissue attenuation within the middle ear and almost all of the mastoid air cells. This is again a otomastoiditis. Another patient who has got a repeated inflammation, okay, and again lot of soft tissue filling some of the mastoid cells. You start getting some sclerosis here and you start getting large cells formation here. So you start getting walls get broken down because of the pressure and enzymes, and it's gradually getting coalescent, and this is coalescent mastoiditis, and then it will lead on to a sclerotic changes. Here is a soft tissue which is located in the attic, non-dependent location. It's actually at the Prusak space, as you can see here in the axial plane. And there's blunting of the scutum. The scutum is here eroded and blunted. And compared to a normal scutum which is sharp, and the ossicular chain is eroded. The ice cream is little eroded here. The cone is also a little unhealthy. And the tegmen is actually eroded. So you got a diagnosis which I'm sure everybody knows now is a cholesteatoma. So this is an easy diagnosis to make. So if you see a soft tissue, you look for all these abnormalities. Look at the tegmen, look at the location of the ossicles, look at the erosions on this side or that side, look at the scutum. This also gives you contributory information to make the diagnosis of cholesteatoma. Then you have to look for the complications, and that's where the key thing for radiologist is lying, is to exclude complications. Because we all know that cholesteatoma is a benign lesion, but it is an expanding and a destructive epithelial lesion. Here there is ossicular chain erosion. Here there is the tegmen is thin and eroded. Here it is significantly eroded, and it is also extending into the internal ear. There is complete erosion here, and there is also erosion of the lateral wall as well. The complications are here for you to see. So this is one of the classifications, and we all wanted to give some classifications in every lecture, but as you can see, pars flaccida, pars tensa, cholesteatomas, secondary to perforation or congenital, and the location classification is one thing, so-called the stamp system. The difficult access sites, the sinus tympanic cholesteatoma, anterior epitympanic rhesus cholesteatoma comes under this so-called S, then the tympanic cholesteatoma, attic location and mastoid location, and the sites, the difficult access sites are the S1 and S2. So stage one is if is in one location, stage 2 is 2 or more, stage 3 is extracranial intratemporal complications like lateral semicircular canal erosion, and stage 4 has gone into the intracranial complications. I don't routinely use this, I just tell the description, I don't tell is there any complications. So specifically there's one paragraph dedicated for tegmen erosion and all those things. It is there, it is not there, I tend to mention it. And here is a patient, large soft tissue eroding the sinus plate, eroding the tegmen, eroding the semicircular canal and forming a labyrinthine fistula. So this is again, if you look for it, you'll be able to see it every time. And again, you can see the defect, and it is not a, you know, a big science here. And here is a patient whose ice cream is intact, but the cone is eroded. As you can see, that's a normal, that's abnormal. And there is here another soft tissue here, which is actually going close to the horizontal facial nerve canal. And that is something you might want to mention to your clinician, that the soft tissue is very close to the inferior margin of the horizontal facial nerve canal. And another patient was eroded and going into the external ear, okay. Cholesteatoma can come into the external ear, either from the middle ear and occasionally de novo within the external artery canal. Another patient who has got a soft tissue here eroding, and then you do a CT scan and see an abscess formation in the temporal fossa, again a complication of cholesteatoma with an intracranial complication. And this patient who has got a lot of erosions involving the facial nerve canal here near the first part of the facial nerve, and the horizontal facial nerve canal area is also involved with the horizontal semicircular canal is also eroded, and there is also little expansion which is happening at the posterior genu in the region of facial nerve. This patient did not have any history of surgery, but there was some sort of a defect which was happening, and patient had a history of something discharged. This is like an automastectomy created by the cholesteatoma. Another patient, you can see here, the scutum is intact, a child. There is a soft tissue here. There is thinning and expansion of the lateral mastoid wall. The tegmen is intact. There is some blunting of the head of malleus, and there was no history of ear discharge or infections, but there is an ossicular chain erosion, and this is where you suggest the possibility of a congenital cholesteatoma. So congenital cholesteatoma, usually the scutum is intact and there is no history of ear discharge. Sometimes it is difficult, and it's the sort of location which is commonly mentioned in textbooks, but often it's sort of there everywhere. It's a young male patient presented with meatal stenosis and hearing loss. They thought it was a congenital middle ear anomaly. Then you can see here large lesion here within the right mastoid middle ear going everywhere, and you can see it here. And then we give final diagnosis was actually a congenital cholesteatoma in this patient. And this patient, we did an MRI as well. As you can see, MR, the appearances of cholesteatoma is high signal on T2, low signal on T1. Does not show enhancement following contrast, because these are all non-vascular epithelial pearls, and shows sometimes a rim enhancement. And you can see here sometimes a thin rim enhancement can be present due to marginal granulation. And non-EPA DWA imaging has been promoted as one of the areas to pick up cholesteatoma if you are not sure what it is. And this is called non-EPA DWA in Philips, turbospin echo DWA in Siemens, propeller in GE, and there's some papers published on this as well. So here is a patient who has got surgery done. There are some soft tissues still there. They wanted to know, is that a cholesteatoma or not? So already surgery done, so it's very difficult for you to suggest, is that a cholesteatoma or not? The non-EPA DWI, you see this diffusion restriction, and it gives a confidence to say, yes, there is some residual cholesteatoma is left. Another patient who is actually a child, discharge was there, and the patient was having a sinus plate erosion. There's a defect. There is ossicular chain erosion. This was from last month, and there is also tegmen thinning, and we all know this is a cholesteatoma. And because of the sinus plate erosion and thinning, we did an MRI, and during the MRI, did the venogram, make sure it is intact, but also did the non-EPA DWI. You can see this diffusion restriction in a cholesteatoma. And this was confirmed on surgery. So different patient who has got an ossicular long-standing ear discharge, and you start seeing small bony spicules surrounding the ossicles. So that means it is, you can see this tiny bony spicules. So this is actually a long-standing disease, a soft tissue in the middle ear with calcification, and this is tympanosclerosis. We'll be right back.